you soon. Anyway, so I'm going to give you one more massive speech. By the way, are any of you recording the debates? What time do they even start tonight? 9, 10, 9. Okay, I mean, I'll hurry up, but obviously it's gone 9 o'clock already. But I'm not going to talk politics with you because whatever, they're your opinions. Do whatever you want with your opinions. But I'm sure you can imagine who I would support, right? You can imagine who I would support. Because sometimes I feel a bit, I mean, to be honest, it's none of my business. I'm not even American, so it's not really my business, really, is it? But sometimes I feel a bit guilty about not saying anything. But if you know who I would support, obviously you know who I would support. But that's fine. I'm not American. But anyway, I'm going to give you my speech on one of my songs. It has nothing to do with him. And this song changed my life when I wrote it. It was the 21 period, which I would say was the lowest point of my life so far to date. That's not a joke, that's actually real. And I heard someone laughing. And when I wrote this next song, I would say it was the real lowest of the low point. And I'd actually written 4 or 5 songs for the 21 album before I got to the point where I was on my knees needing something to happen, and I didn't know what it was. But I'm sure you'll all agree that when a relationship ends, and especially when it wasn't your choice that it ended, it feels like the world is over and that you're never going to be in another relationship again and that you're going to be upset forever. Obviously, for most of us, we do move on, and then we just got the biggest prick of all time for being that dramatic about a relationship that was obviously never meant to be. But you know, this was one of those moments for me, and I felt very worthless and powerless, and I felt like I just felt lonely. I felt, you know, that real horrible, empty feeling of being lonely. And I was like, I am going to take myself back. I am going to own myself, and I'm going to write a song, which is something that I've always done to deal with real life. I don't really like real life for the best of times. So, you know, when I want to deal with it, I write a song. And and whenever I plan to do that any time before this song, or have ever tried since, nothing has ever happened. So for some reason, the world was on my side on this one day, and within a couple of hours I had the first verse and the first chorus, and I felt different. I felt like this song was going to change my life, not with the success that it ended up having, but just in the way that I felt about myself and the things that I knew I wanted for myself going forward. And I wrote this song on guitar, but it wasn't quite heartbreaking enough, so we put it onto piano just to make it a little bit more emotional, as if it needed it. And this song is I know it sounds sad, but it's not. I know I always play the witch and the bitch when it comes to that relationship when I was 21, but it was a really important part of my life because, like I just said, it made me who I am, it made me know what I wanted and stuff like that, so I'm eternally grateful for it. Obviously, I've got the album as well, so I really, you know, what I said earlier, I did come out on top because he is still in the same place. For being blessed to have that kind of relationship when I did, because it doesn't happen to all of us, and I felt very, very lucky that I'd experienced it. So this song I did about 5 years ago on a stage very similar to this, although it wasn't my stage, it was a stage at the Brit Awards, which is like our version of the Grammys at home in England. And I wasn't supposed to be there. It wasn't, you know, I wasn't eligible. It wasn't, you know, I wasn't supposed to be there. So I was very uncomfortable. I mean, I don't like doing anything, as you know. So the fact that I was at this award ceremony with no reason to be there, I was humiliated. But I was worried that everyone thought, oh, like, she thinks she's winning something and she ain't. I mean, I don't really care. But, you know, I'm like, oh, God, I don't want to do it. And I sang this next song. And then I flew to New York, bring it back to New York once again. I flew here after that, and within those 7 hours of my flight, my life changed completely, and my life has never ever been the same ever since. And it changed in every single way you could ever imagine. It changed in incredible ways and very strange ways, and in ways I will never ever get my head around. And I know sometimes I come across like I don't enjoy what I do, and I don't enjoy what you've enabled me to do, which is just sing for a living, which is all I ever wanted to do when I was a kid. I do enjoy it, I need to step away from it every now and then for a really long time, in fairness. I will go away again, but I will come back in order to live a real life so that I can appreciate it most I can, but also to write songs that are real for you, because some people I know that do what I do, they have no idea what happens in real life. I don't want to write an album about that. I don't want to write an album where I'm imagining what real life is about. I want to live real life, and that's why I disappear. And it's not because I don't enjoy it. So this song is no longer my song. It had this song I kind of not disowned it in a bad way, but I was like, okay, you know, I let it go, and it belongs to you guys now. And I know that lots of people and lots of people in this room let this song soundtrack moments in their life, and I will never ever know what those moments are, but I do often, you know, wonder what they are, and I feel truly blessed that you let this song into your life the way you did. So this is for you. Let's sing along. I want to have a massive sing-along and be 15,000 desperados, even if we're not anymore. This is Someone Like You. Thank you for coming to my show, New York.
Back. healing.